Okay, our next speaker is Joshua Garcia. He is currently a project scientist with ISR. He received his PhD with ISR's very own Nino Medvedevich at USC. And I'm thrilled to announce that in a few weeks, Josh is going to be joining us as a new faculty in the department. So,
hooray.
Super excited.
Thanks for the introduction, Jim. So I'm going to change up the styles of the talks a bit. I'm actually going to talk about just one study and the results that we've been conducting here at Software Engineering and Analysis Lab at UCI. And so to begin this talk, let's look at the mobile operating system market share. And what you're going to notice here is that Android has an overwhelming majority of that market share, 85% to be exact. And that's way more than the other mobile OSs combined. And not only does Android have such a large market share, it also has a lot of malware. So what you're seeing here, is a timeline between January 2011 through April 2017, and you're seeing the explosive growth of malware in that time period. In particular, if you just focus on May 2014 through April 2017, you'll see that that growth has been more than six times in terms of that size. And so to protect themselves, what smartphone users often rely upon are commercial anti-malware products, like the one shown here. So for instance, you see McAfee, AGV, Avast, QuickKills, Sophos, Norton, Symantec, and so on. And so when these commercial anti-malware products try to detect the malware on one of your devices, these malware are going to try to evade detection. And oftentimes, they're going to rely upon code obfuscations like renaming identifiers, encryption of strings and arrays, a reflection, the ability of an app to inspect or modify itself during runtime, and so on. And so what these code obfuscations do is they transform a program so that it becomes more difficult to reverse engineer while still preserving the semantics of the program. And so what you're seeing here is an Android package kit. It's a zipped up file that stores the actual Android application, and it consists of three different elements. The Android manifest file, which describes, for example, the different components in the app, the permissions in the app. There's also the dex file, which actually contains, for instance, the compiled bytecode of the app, and there's resources in the app, so for example, raw images. And so what an obfuscation strategy is going to do is it's going to take these three different parts of an app. It will apply one of these obfuscation strategies and reproduce the APK for you in an obfuscated form. And so these obfuscations, they're not just good for malicious authors that are trying to evade detection. They're also good for benign app developers, because one of the reasons you want to apply obfuscations is because you want to make it harder for the intellectual property in your code to be engineered. And so along those lines, lots of obfuscation tools have been built to protect those kinds of intellectual property. These include commercial, academic, and open source tools. So for example, in the commercial space, we have Alatori. In the open source space, we have one of the most widely used tools called ProGuard. And we also have research or academic tools such as Jordan. And so these obfuscation tools implemented by a variety of obfuscation strategies. We've categorized these strategies into three different types. Trivial strategies, which don't change the bytecode. So for example, modifications or transformations that Android manifests are such trivial strategies. There are non-trivial strategies, which actually change the bytecode. Those include some of the ones I described earlier, but also include jump code insertion, control flow manipulation, and so forth. And of course, you can also combine these strategies to hopefully make it even harder to reverse engineer those programs. And so our overall research goal in this study is to assess the performance of commercial anti-malware products against obfuscation strategies and obfuscation tools. To that end, we conducted a large-scale empirical study where we've taken a wide variety of those obfuscation tools and strategies, commercial anti-malware products. We took over 73,000 malicious and benign apps. We also looked at the relation of time, in particular Google Apps, and anti-malware effectiveness in terms of ability to evade detection. We also look at the effects of the obfuscations that result from the obfuscation tools. We want to see if those tools actually produce runnable and installable apps. And so for this study, we look into the following four research questions. The first research question relates to obfuscation strategies with anti-malware products. We want to see the extent to which those obfuscation strategies affect the detection rate of these anti-malware products. For our second research question, we look at the effect of obfuscation tools on the commercial anti-malware products. For the third research question, we look at whether or not time affects commercial anti-malware products. Specifically, we look at the age of apps, both obfuscated and not, to see if the detection rates vary over time. Finally, for the fourth research question, we looked at the obfuscation tools themselves, and we evaluated whether or not the apps they produce are still runnable, they exhibit the same kind of behaviors they did before during runtime, and whether or not we can even install the apps on the devices that run Android. We used the following experimental setup for this study. We took seven tools from the three different types of obfuscation tools that we looked at before, in particular whether or not they're from academia, commercial, or open source. We looked at about 30 different obfuscation strategies, the trivial, non-trivial, and combined obfuscation strategies I talked about earlier. For Android apps, we took 3,000 benign apps and 3,000 malicious apps. We applied the 30 obfuscation strategies and 7 tools, giving us over 73,000 obfuscated apps. Finally, in terms of commercial anti-malware products, we obtained over 60 of them. And these are the most downloaded, most popular commercial anti-malware products you can find on Google Play, popular also in terms of user ratings as well. We built an obfuscation framework to conduct this study. In particular, we designed this framework to be reusable and extensible. In fact, you can go download it yourself and reproduce the study or use it for another study or whatever you want to do. And so let's look at the results of the study, starting with the first research question. We're concerned about the effects of the specific obfuscation strategies on these anti-malware products. So our first finding is that these code obfuscations decrease the detection rate of commercial anti-malware products on average by 20%, all the way up to 90%. That's a major decrease in those detection rates just from simple obfuscation strategies. In fact, let's look at one of them, the manifest transformation. It's a trivial strategy, it doesn't change bytecode, but on average, it will decrease the detection rates of these anti-malware products by about 30%. Some researchers of security believe that reflection, the ability of an app to inspect or modify itself during runtime, will help you evade having your malicious app detected by one of these anti-malware products. Well, in fact, what our study found is that the opposite is true. It's going to make your app suspicious. In fact, the more you use reflection, the more your benign app is going to end up being marked as malicious by these commercial anti-malware products. The last finding I'm going to be covering for this particular research question is the effect of combined strategies compared to individual transformations. And in fact, what we found is if you combine transformations, the effect on the detection rate isn't any more or less than you would find it with individual transformations. And so in particular, if you're a benign app developer and you want to protect your Android programs, it actually helps to combine strategies, because it's not going to have your apps mistakenly marked as malicious. So we're going to move on to the next research question. This time we're going to look at the effects of the obfuscation tools themselves on the commercial anti-malware products. And this chart shows those results. In particular, what you're seeing are box plots for each of the 7 obfuscation tools we looked at, plus the original apps, and those box plots are along the y-axis shown here, is the detection rate. So what you're seeing is that the obfuscation tools on the right most affect the detection rate of the commercial products. So for example, you're seeing ProGuard and Dashio really affecting the detection rates. On the left, you'll see the ones that affect the detection rate least, Atom, APK tool/Jarsigner. And overall, you're finding that the detection rate varies based on the obfuscation tools. And I'm going to get back more to this particular point later in the talk. So for the third research question, we're going to look at the relation of time in commercial anti-malware products. In particular, what we're concerned about here is the age of the app and how well those different commercial anti-malware products do over time. The particular time period we're looking at here is 2008 to 2017. And so what you're seeing is the results for the original apps and the apps after obfuscation. You'll see that the obfuscated apps are being detected less by about 20%, consistent with the findings we found earlier. But also what you're noticing is that over time, all these commercial anti-malware products are doing worse for the newer apps, in particular from 2010 through 2017. And so what this is showing is that these commercial anti-malware products are slow to adopt malicious signatures and actually have a hard time identifying zero-day malware. So malware that you want to see before. The last question I'll be looking at is whether these obfuscation tools can actually produce apps that can be installed and run on your Android device. So by installable, I simply mean that we're going to be able to successfully install and deploy these apps onto your Android device. For runnable, what I'm looking for is similar behavior of the app both before and after obfuscation. To test that, what we did is we took Android Monkey. It is an automated tool from Google that produces random events to test your app. We selected 1,000 events for Monkey per app. We use the same seed per app so that we can ensure we provide the same input both before and after obfuscation. And we tested this runnability in an order aware and order agnostic fashion. So what do those terms mean? Well, runnability in an order aware fashion is concerned with seeing the same set of components in the same order of execution both before and after obfuscation. So let's look at this execution trace here of an app before obfuscation. And what we're seeing is execution of component C1 followed by C2 and finally C3. In the order aware case, we still want to see those same three sets of components and we want to see them execute in that exact same order. In the order agnostic case, we're going to still see the same set of components executing both before and after obfuscation, but this time the order of execution for those components don't matter anymore. So for example, what you're seeing here is that C2 executes, followed by C3, and then C1. And so here are the results for this final research question we're looking at. What we did is we tested these different obfuscation tools using 250 apps. And here are the results for all the 7 obfuscation tools. What you're seeing is that a good number of them can at least produce nearly all apps that are installable. However, once we look at the runnability, the similarity of behavior both before and after obfuscation, we see reductions. So some apps, for example, Jarsigner, APK tool, ProGuard, they still do a good job of exhibiting the same behavior in an order agnostic fashion. However, once we concern ourselves with order aware behavior, do we actually see these components in a similar order as before? We see that drop significantly. So for example, none of the tools were able to produce more than 150 apps out of 250 that exhibited this order aware runnable behavior. In fact, the obfuscated apps were only runnable and installable from 0% to 62% of those 250 apps. And so what can we learn from all this? Well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to discuss lessons learned from the point of view of anti-malware product vendors and developers of obfuscation tools and benign apps. So in terms of anti-malware product vendors, one of the things that you can learn from the study is that a deeper analysis needs to be conducted to be able to identify this malware. A lot of these analyses seem to be just lexical analyses. They don't actually look at program semantics. And doing that will actually really help in terms of detecting these malware. For benign app developers, you should avoid reflection in general. In fact, in terms of an Android app, reflection doesn't make much sense. Reflection in the case of programs is often used to, for example, provide frameworks and libraries so that you can determine specific functionality that should be executed during runtime. But the higher up you are on the program stack, the less it makes sense. As I said earlier, combined obfuscations is fine for your benign apps. It may protect your apps more, but it's not going to get you detected as malicious when, in fact, you aren't. And for obfuscation tool developers, you saw the results earlier. The behaviors seem to change a good amount over time, and so there seems to be some improvement, a significant amount of improvement that can be done along that particular dimension. And also in terms of lessons learned, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to relate these obfuscation tools in terms of installability and runnability and their effects on commercial anti-malware products. So for example, let's focus on the upper right corner of this chart. And what you're going to see here is a part of the chart that's ideal for benign app developers, obfuscation tool developers, and commercial anti-malware product makers. And this is ideal because you have a high percentage in terms of installability and runability, and you also have high average detection rates of malicious apps. And so for example, what we're seeing is, besides the original apps having that property, apk2/jarsigner has that property as well. Now, if we look at the upper left corner of this chart, you can see the space where you want to be if you want to be a bad guy, if you want to be a malicious author. Here you see high rates of installability and runnability, but low rates of detection from these commercial anti-malware products. And in particular, ProGuard and Droid Chameleon exhibit those properties. And ProGuard is particularly interesting because it's widely used and it basically just doesn't identify or name. And so in conclusion, what I've shown you is a large-scale empirical study of the effects on commercial anti-malware products when using obfuscation tools and strategies. If there's one point that I'd like you to take away here is that on average, these simple obfuscations reduce the results of commercial anti-malware products by 20% all the way up to 90%. Okay, so now I've been talking about all sorts of different problems with the anti-malware space. What are we going to do about it? Are we just going to continue using these tools that are problematic in a variety of different ways? Well, actually, we have a solution for this. It's called Reveal Droid. It can actually detect all these different kinds of malware, despite these obfuscations. And so I'll just leave you with that, and feel free to come to talk to us about that if you like. I'd also really like to acknowledge Mahmoud and Sam. Mahmoud is the PhD student who did the real work on this. And Sam is the guy that does the real work on me and Mahmoud. So thank you very much for your time and attention.